Let us worship God and sing to his praise from Psalm 25, the first version, verses 8 to 14. The tune is our tune, new tune for the month of December, Carry, which is tune number 166. Psalm 25, the first version, verses 8 to 14. Notice verse 11. Now for thine own namesake, O Lord, I thee entreat to pardon mine iniquity, for it is very great. Here we have the Lord coming to us and training us to seek pardon, not only for the benefits we receive from it, but for the glory of his own name, especially in light of the greatness of our sin. Let's sing verses 8 to 14. Seek God's face together in prayer. Our great and glorious God in heaven, we come to bow down our hearts once again, to acknowledge that you are the incomparable God, that there is none in all of this vast universe and none outside of it that can be likened unto you, one who is cloaked in majesty and glory. We would, O Lord, acknowledge that you are holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, that you are altogether separate from sinners and of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. You are a God unstained by the foolishness and wickedness of this sin-cursed world. You are a God who rather is pure in all your ways. And we, O Lord, are conscious that as we come gathering again in your presence, that we are none of these things. We confess, O Lord, that we are unholy, that rather than having a native majesty, we have defiled ourselves, that we are like the fallen world into which we have been conceived and born. And so left to ourselves, we would be cast into outer darkness, separated from your gracious presence and mercy. That we would, O Lord, be children of wrath, saving up wrath for the wrath to come. That nothing would await us except those grave, those sobering, even terrifying words, "Depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, I never knew you." This is our lot, O Lord, by right and birth. And yet we come not into your presence with presumption. We come, O Lord, on the basis of the strong and precious promises given to us in Christ Jesus, in which all of them are yea and amen in him. We come, O Lord, acknowledging our sin while cleaving to his righteousness. We come, O Lord, acknowledging our failures while clinging to his blood, which cleanses us from all sin. And we would pray, as we have just sung, that for your own name's sake, O Lord, for your glory, that you would cleanse us from all of our iniquities, pardon us from our sins. O Lord, you are pleased to manifest the wonder of your redeeming grace to the angels and onlookers in heaven, as well as to the sons of men, that you are a God who is just, and yet the justifier of the ungodly, a God who has undertaken in the sending of Christ Jesus as a substitute and as the Lamb of God, the sacrifice for the sins of your people, satisfying, O Lord, all of the demands of your law, meeting all of the terms of your own character, ensuring that sin would not go unpunished. You were pleased to cause Christ to be afflicted, to be bruised for our iniquities, in order that we might be found acceptable in him. We thank you, O Lord, for this wonderful gospel message and for the good that it has brought to us, not only for a time, but for eternity, for the blessings that it imparts into our present life, for the sweetness that we have of enjoying your fellowship in your presence, for the boldness it imparts to our souls to come into the throne room with all of our petitions and praise, for the way in which, O Lord, you have delivered us from the domination of sin, taking us as slaves and making us free in Christ Jesus to serve you with godliness. O Lord, we ask that you would indeed forgive all of our sins, the sins of this very day. We are conscious that every sin on the Sabbath is in fact a double sin. And how we see, O Lord, and mourn the sins of our thoughts and distractions, our misplaced affections, our foolish words and actions, we grieve over them and we confess, O Lord, come and show us mercy, fresh mercy, yet again this day. And we pray that you would be pleased to enable us to fear you, that we would be a people who walk in the fear of God and in the joy of the Holy Ghost, that we would know what it means to fear the living God. We pray, grant that this grace would abound in us, not only in our approach to worship, but in the daily lives which we lead and all of the varied responsibilities that we hold and all of the things that you have called us to pursue, may your fear be found in us, and may we be marked out by it to your own praise. We ask that you would bless your word to us. We thank you for it. O Lord, we beg you, take not the Holy Scriptures away from us. If we look at our lives and the ways in which we have handled the privilege of access to your word, we are ashamed of ourselves. We have not kept the things delivered in the preaching of your word, nor responded to them with action and obedience, received them with faith. We have not saturated ourselves in the Bible, in the singing of your praise, and in the memorization of your and meditation upon your word as we ought. And we, O Lord, it would be just if you were to take it away from us altogether, and yet we would plead with you afresh that you would give us this word to stay with us, that you would give us the pure ordinances that you've appointed, and that they would not be corrupted or removed, and that you would impart to us, O Lord, an increased appetite, a love, a delight, a joy in your word, that we would, with fresh exercise of our souls, labor over it and in it, that we would be a people who are minding your voice and following your directions as you have clearly laid them out for us. We ask that this word would be given free course and be glorified among us, that you, O Lord, would be pleased both here, very near to us, in our neighborhood and communities, as well as very far from us, that as the word goes forth, that you would cause it to go forth conquering and to conquer, that you would use it as the sword of the Spirit to slay every form of disobedience and superstition and unbelief, that you would, O Lord, use it as a net to draw sinners to yourself in the free offer of the gospel, that you would be pleased, O Lord, to subdue us under your lordship, the reign of your word over us. We pray, work these things by your Spirit in our hearts and lives and in our souls. We ask as well, O Lord, that you would continue to bring forth the appropriate fruit of this word, that the fruit of the Holy Spirit would not just be noticed and noticeable, but that you would cause us to abound in it for the sake of your own glory. You have taught us that you are glorified through the fruitfulness of your people, that you are pleased to come into our lives and prune us painfully at times, to remove dead wood and idols from our hearts in order that you might yet get more glory for yourself. And we would have it to be so, O Lord. We desire to glorify you and thus fulfill our chief end. We ask that you would be pleased to take the gospel preached already in our hearing this day, and that it would not be stolen away by Satan, that it would not be choked out by the cares of this world and the vanity of riches, that it would not merely bring the premature fruit of springing up with joy and dying out, but that you, O Lord, would yet be pleased to take and burn that word into the hearts of each and every one of us, that we would be pressed to answer the question we heard, "Believest thou this?" And that we, O Lord, would be enabled to say, "Yea, Lord, I believe," that we believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, and that you, O Lord, would be pleased to help us, that as we believe, that you also would help our unbelief. We pray, O Lord, for your wisdom, that you would deliver us from the foolish, devilish wisdom of this world, which is shouting in our ears and being set before our eyes, the temptation toward pragmatics, the temptation to follow the ways of the world and lean on the arm of flesh. Rather, Lord, give us that wisdom which is from above, which is peaceful and pure. Grant, Lord, that we would have the wisdom of Christ, that we would be able to discern between good and evil through the exercise of our senses, that we would be trained, O Lord, in the truth that you've given. We ask that you would bless those institutions which have been established for the instruction of your word in seminaries that we know of, Reformed seminaries that we know and love. We pray that you would please grant them to be bastions of light. We're conscious of the pressures, the temptations to dilute the truth, to make compromises, to be carried off with trends and peripheral issues. We ask that you would root and ground them, O Lord, in the solid and fertile soil of Reformed Orthodoxy, and that they would be enabled to teach the whole counsel of God, and that in doing so, you would raise up men equipped to do the same as they go into their places, respective places, that you call them to labor in word and doctrine and to preach in season and out of season. We ask that you would bless the schooling of our children in the various forms that it takes, that they would not only learn their reading and writing and arithmetic, but that they would be taught the things of God, and that they would know much of your truth, that they would be prepared so that as your Spirit adds saving grace and blessing to them, that they might serve as meet instruments for your glory in their generation. We pray for future generations, for children and children's children and great-grandchildren and beyond, those who have been who are unborn and unthought of at this point. And we ask that you would go before, O Lord, and that you would be raising up from the seed, that you will create those who will serve in their own generation, that this, our own city, would not be left without a faithful witness in the generations to come, but that you would preserve for yourself a testimony, and those who stand in whatever day they find themselves, laboring fervently for your glory and your word. We ask that you would bless us in our worship this afternoon, that you would stir us up to seek you, that you would give mental acuity and alertness, that you would give strength and energy to our bodies, and that most of all, you would draw out our faith and the exercise of our souls in each ordinance that you have appointed, and that we would in them find Christ, and that we would delight in him, and that we would again fall down and worship. For we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord by singing from Psalm 89, verses 6 to 10. The tune is Effingham, number 56. Psalm 89, the verses are 6 to 10. Look with me at the repetition of the theme in verse 6 and again in verse 8. For who in heaven with the Lord may once himself compare? Who is like God among the sons of those that mighty are? In verse 8, O thou that art the Lord of hosts. It's one of his favorite titles. O thou that art the Lord of hosts, what Lord in mightiness is like to thee? Who compassed round art with thy faithfulness? We'll sing verses 6 to 10. Our Old Testament reading is found in 1 Kings chapter 15. First Kings 15, beginning at verse 1. Let us give careful heed to the reading of God's word. Now in the 18th year of King Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, reigned Abijam over Judah. 3 years reigned he in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishalom. And he walked in all the sins of his father, which he had done before him. And his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as the heart of David his father. Nevertheless, for David's sake, did the Lord his God give him a lamp in Jerusalem, to set up his son after him and to establish Jerusalem. Because David did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, and turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life, save only in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. And there was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam all the days of his life. Now the rest of the acts of Abijam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? And there was war between Abijam and Jeroboam. And Abijam slept with his fathers, and they buried him in the city of David, and Asa his son reigned in his stead. In the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah, and 41 years reigned he in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishalom. And Asa did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father. And he took away the Sodomites out of the land, and removed all the idols that his father had made. And also Maacah, his mother, even her he removed from being queen, because she had made an idol in a grove. And Asa destroyed her idol and burnt it by the brook Kidron. But the high places were not removed. Nevertheless, Asa's heart was perfect with the Lord all his days. And he brought in the things which his father had dedicated and the things which himself had dedicated into the house of the Lord, silver and gold and vessels. And there was war between Asa and Baasha, king of Israel, all their days. And Baasha, king of Israel, went up against Judah and built Ramah, that he might not suffer any to go out or come in to Asa, king of Judah. Then Asa took all the silver and the gold that were left in the treasuries of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house and delivered them into the hand of his servants. And King Asa sent them to Ben-Hadad, the son of Tabrimon, the son of Hezion, king of Syria, that dwelt at Damascus, saying, "There is a league between me and thee, and between my father and thy father. Behold, I have sent unto thee a present of silver and gold. Come and break thy league with Baasha, king of Israel, that he may depart from me." So Ben-Hadad hearkened unto King Asa, and sent the captains of the hosts which he had against the cities of Israel, and smote Ijon, and Dan, and Abel-Beth-Maacah, and all Kinneroth, with all the land of Naphtali. It came to pass, when Baasha heard thereof, that he left off building of Ramah, and dwelt in Tirzah. Then King Asa made a proclamation throughout all Judah. None was exempted, and they took away the stones of Ramah, and the timber thereof, wherewith Baasha had builded, and King Asa built with them Geba of Benjamin and Mizpah. The rest of all the acts of Asa and all his might and all that he did and the cities which he built, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? Nevertheless, in the time of his old age, he was diseased in his feet, and Asa slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David his father, and Jehoshaphat his son reigned in his stead. And Nadab the son of Jeroboam began to reign over Israel in the second year of Asa king of Judah, and reigned over Israel 2 years. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the way of his father, and in his sin wherewith he made Israel to sin. Baasha, the son of Ahijah of the house of Issachar, conspired against him. Baasha smote him at Gibbethon, which belonged to the Philistines. For Nadab and all Israel laid siege to Gibbethon. Even in the third year of Asa, king of Judah, did Baasha slay him and reigned in his stead. And it came to pass when he reigned that he smote all the house of Jeroboam. He left not to Jeroboam any that breathed until he had destroyed him according unto the saying of the Lord, which he spake by his servant Ahijah the Shilonite. Because of the sins of Jeroboam which he sinned, and which he made Israel sin by his provocation wherewith he provoked the Lord God of Israel to anger. Now the rest of the acts of Nadab and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? And there was war between Asa and Baasha, king of Israel, all their days. In the third year of Asa, king of Judah, began Baasha, the son of Ahijah, to reign over all Israel in Tirzah 24 years. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the way of Jeroboam, and in his sin wherewith he made Israel to sin. Amen, and may God bless the reading of this portion of his word. Lift up our hearts and voices in singing to the Lord from Psalm 89, verses 11 to 14. Psalm 89, 11 to 14, to the tune Dunfermline, which is tune number 51. We see at the beginning of this psalm the reference that God, the reference to the fact that God has entered into a covenant with his people. We're going to come on further to see some of the ways in which they break that covenant. But here in this section, notice especially verse 13, "Thou hast an arm that's full of power, thy hand is great in might, and thy right hand exceedingly exalted is in height." Here we are extolling the Lord for his own power, coupled with his faithfulness. This is the security and comfort of the Lord's people. So let's sing verses 11 to 14.
The world and fullness of God.
Our New Testament reading is found in Revelation chapter 3, so if you'll take your Bibles and turn with me there. Last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 3. This is the second of two chapters that address Christ's word to the churches in Asia. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, These things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain, that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews, and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world, to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. He that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, These things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich, and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, and miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Amen. Thus far, the reading of God's inspired word. Let's turn back together to the first portion that we read earlier in our service to 1 Kings chapter 15, and we'll be considering the middle section of this chapter with the Lord's help, verses 9 to 24. So our text is 1 Kings 15, verses 9 through verse 24. It begins, "And in the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah." Let me begin with a question. Have you ever been in a hot, stuffy, dank room when someone has come through and opened a window and a fresh, cool, crisp, clean breeze has blown into the room and hit you in the face? There's something refreshing about that experience, something exhilarating or invigorating when we have those kinds of experiences. And it reflects, I think, it's a good analogy to what we see at various points in the history of the church, both biblical and post-biblical. We see periods where there is this dark and dank atmosphere looming over the landscape, spiritual death in the air. And the Lord is pleased to open, as it were, a door in heaven and to send forth the breeze of His Spirit in order to revive and to refresh His church. You'll remember that one of the mottos of the Reformation was light out of darkness. It was as if they had been groping about in the dark for a period, and the Lord shined down from heaven light, gospel light, biblical light, into Europe and brought down great blessings from heaven upon His people. You'll see this at various points in England during the Reformation. Some of you will know, and those who don't should, about the reign of Edward VI, the boy king, sometimes called the Josiah of England. He began to reign when he was 9 and died when he was 15. But this young king was an instrument of tremendous reformation. And yet there was nothing, humanly speaking, that gave promise to him. Who was his father? King Henry VIII, who was debauched. Yes, he had thumbed his nose at the Pope and kicked Rome out of England, but only for personal reasons, rather than for theological and spiritual reasons, in order to gratify his insatiable appetite for women, having 6 wives, none of whom he was faithful to, and much more. One would have thought, well, there's no hope for young Edward VI, and yet the Lord raised him up, and he was a mighty instrument. In concert with some of the reformers living at the time to bring about much good to that kingdom. All of that provides illustration to what we find in this text. We find the appearance of Asa in the passage before us, this king of Judah. And he appears to come to us out of nowhere. He is perhaps the least thing expected as we're reading down through the Bible. Looking at what's gone before him, there should have been nothing promising about Asa. Most people would have drawn the conclusion, like father, like son, like grandfather and father, so like son. He was an unlikely candidate, and yet the Lord raised him up. Jeroboam, his grandfather, had engaged in all sorts of wickedness, consulting with the vanity of his youthful colleagues, oppressing the people, introducing all sorts of idolatry. His son after him, Abijam, continued in the same, proliferating the high places, the false gods, the pagan altars, and so on. Even his mother, Maacah, a wicked woman, as we'll see more in a moment. And yet, out of all of this morass of bleak circumstances, the Lord is pleased to raise up a God-fearing testimony for himself. And so that's where we find ourselves in 1 Kings. We're going to note 2 things this afternoon about the verses that we've marked out. First of all, implementing Reformation. You see this in verses 9 to 15. So first of all, implementing Reformation. There are some very important indicators here in our text. The first is in verse 11, "And Asa did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father." Not what was right in the eyes of his fathers, not what was right in the eyes of his contemporaries, not what was right according to worldly wisdom, but what was right in the eyes of the Lord. We see here that external reformation begins with internal godliness. We're not just moving around and rearranging the chairs of the kingdom. This external reform commences with this internal godliness. Asa had a heart for God. That's what we know most about him. Just as David had a heart for God. What do we see after that? We see that biblical reformation has always and will always focus first and foremost on the worship of God. So with a heart for God, he sets about the work of reformation, focusing chiefly upon God's worship. Now, what this means is this. If one has a heart for God, then one ought to know God's own heart. And what the Bible reveals to us is that God's priority is his own worship. And the reason for that is because it is so intricately linked to his glory and his majesty. And so Asa is quick to get rid of the male temple prostitutes, to eradicate sodomy from the land, and to set about this work of reformation. He succeeds where his fathers had failed. He has a heart for the Lord and his worship, and so he goes about busily destroying idolatry. He engages in a nationwide, comprehensive plan of iconoclasm. He's going to destroy the idols that had come before him. My friends, only the grace of God can produce such a thing in any person, whether it be prince or pauper. Only gospel grace can produce such an inclination as what we see here. It is the Lord at work. And because it is God's grace, it imparts a tremendous amount of hope to us and to our own families. It's God's grace that produces these things. Now, you may have untold number of skeletons in your family's closet, and all sorts of terrible things in your genealogical tree. But this passage makes clear, whatever our history is, and however unpromising things may look humanly speaking, the Lord's people are not doomed to repeat the sins of their fathers. And they're not doomed to such because of the power of Christ. Because of what we just sang about a moment ago. The power of Christ working by the gospel of his grace in the souls of his people, there is much hope. And there's encouragement to not only pray for ourselves, but to pray for future generations as well. That the Lord would arise and scatter his enemies, and that he would raise up for himself a lamp, a torch, that he would raise up for himself witnesses who would testify to his glory and preserve and defend it to the uttermost. It is appropriate for us to both pray and labor specifically for the eradication of idolatry. If we have a heart for God, then one of the things that ought to be hanging heavy in our minds, in our generation and really in any generation, is the presence of idolatry. So when we see the presence of idolatry in Christ's church, it brings brokenness. It brings burden to the Lord's people. We pray and labor to see these things removed for God's glory. When we look about a nation, in our case, our own nation, and we see the proliferation and protection and promotion of idolatry, it ought to break our hearts. We ought to be burdened to pray and to labor for its removal, to tear down, as it were, all that dishonors God. Now, that includes the things that we find in our own lives as well, the things chiefly that we find in our own hearts and circumstances. We're having to ask the question of ourselves, what is standing in the way for you and for me? Because there are all sorts of idols that cling to us, pleasure, possessions, our own self-interest, and so on. Well, we can be sure of one thing. If we know God, and we do, we know what he's revealed to us about himself, then we know for certain that God is in the business of destroying idols. He makes it one of his chief concerns. When we think about idols, really there are at least three lines of application, I think, that give us a little bit of guidance. And I've used this in the previous sermons. I'll state them explicitly right now. There are at least three lines of application when we think about what the Bible says about idolatry. The first and foremost pertains to the worship of God. That's explicit in this passage and in some of the ones that we have been looking at previously. The presence of unappointed ordinances, superstition, and idolatry within God's own worship. Now, this is something that the Lord's people have zeal about, because God has zeal about it. And that's the first and greatest point of application for us. We're to be thinking about the preservation of the purity of God's worship. The second line of application that we can make, and we'll come back to this in the days ahead, are our own personal idols. So in addition to the ordinances of God's worship, we also can tolerate, even promote, various types of idolatry within our own personal lives. So whenever we have inordinate affection for something that is not the Lord, that's an idol. Whenever we put something in the place that belongs only and exclusively to the Lord, that is an idol. And that can be people, and that can be possessions, and that can be various dreams and pursuits that we have. It can be much of our own selfish interest, as I said. All of these things would be appropriate. Now, we could multiply the list of examples. I'm merely giving you three heads, if you will, three major points, which we could then trace out in detail, three avenues of application. The third area of application would be to societal idols. So again, we're not speaking about the worship of God nor the personal idols that we find in our own hearts, but there are also society-sized idols, so that in any given generation, certain things are elevated and exalted and become the attraction that causes people to be enamored over them. And so people consume their thought, their time, their energy, their enthusiasm, their excitement about these sorts of things. Now, we could name lots of those as well, the kind of things that the world occupies itself with. This, too, is an avenue of application that has to be kept in mind when we're thinking about the demands that the text makes on us. So here is Asa, and he's implementing reformation. He has a heart for God, and therefore a heart for God's worship. But in implementing reformation, notice that this is a costly work. This does not come with the wave of a wand. This does not come sitting upon our beds of ease. It is something that requires of Asa personal sacrifice. There is a price tag that is put on this. And we're going to spell that out. But let me remind you of how Jesus emphasizes this. There are a few places we could turn, but one example would be Luke chapter 14 and verses 26 and 27, because this is related to what we're going to see in 1 Kings 15. If any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Here is Asa, he counts the cost. And the first cost is in his family relationships. There are sacrifices made near and dear to him in his family relationships, verse 13. And also Maacah, his mother, even her he removed from being queen, because she had made an idol in a grove. And Asa destroyed her idol and burnt it by the brook Kidron. Here is the queen mother. Now, the queen mother has more influence and power in these ancient days than nearly anyone save the king, second to the king. You'll see this at various points in the Old Testament. And yet his own mother had turned her heart away from Jehovah. She had turned her back on the word of God and the ways of God. And she had run after idols. Now, one can only imagine the enormous pressure that would have been placed on Asa. It would have been an enormous internal pressure. I mean, this is your mother who nursed you and changed your diapers and put food in your mouth when you're a baby. A sense of very close, intimate, emotional attachment. Internal pressure would have been there. A sense of connection to her. There would have been enormous pressure politically and in the nation as a whole. And these pressures, enormous pressures, would have been to let this pass unpunished. That's where the pressure lies. What does Asa do? He says no. He honors God above his own desires, his mother's desires, and the whole world's desires. He honors God above all. He is determined to let God be God, and for no other to take his place. And so what does he do? He kicks his mother to the curb. He removes her. This is public disgrace. He removes her. She's defrocked, if you will. And she's removed from office as a queen. And then he takes what is near and dear to her, and he burns her idols to ashes. There is sacrifice. It is a costly work to be implementing reformation. The application is obvious. Our commitment to Christ is before any personal relationship on the planet. Our relationship to Christ is first and foremost. We have often talked from this pulpit about first things first. God is put first in everything. That's why the first table of the law gets the first priority in every sphere of life, personal, familial, ecclesiastical, national, and so on. First things first. That may mean a lot of things for the Lord's people. It may mean that at times we need to refuse the endorsement of a sexual lifestyle of someone that is near and dear to us. Right? There are those who have paid that high cost and have said, no, we're going to follow Christ and this is going to cost us dearly. It may be that we have to decline participation in one form of false worship or another. It may be a whole host of things. And it may result in ridicule at college, and it may result in ridicule at work or in the family, but it is a cross that is borne in following the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's a costly work. He also paid financially as well. His father had emptied the coffers and done all sorts of horrible things, And he has to resupply the temple. He brought in the things which his father had dedicated and the things which himself had dedicated into the house of the Lord, silver, gold, and vessels. So we saw previously the gold shields turned to bronze shields. Gold and silver is flowing back into the temple. He is making personal sacrifice. What was lost by Rehoboam, Asa, through his own resources, supplies them for the sake of God's kingdom. This is part of following the Lord Jesus Christ. We serve Christ and his kingdom with our resources. Not, as is often portrayed, will we give to Christ in order to get something. If we give to him our tithes and offerings, then he'll, you know, make us rich and so on. No, that's not the gospel pattern. It's rather a sign of discipleship. Sacrifices for the kingdom kills self and destroys the idol of materialism, among other things. There are temptations, of course, to say, well, I'll give to the Lord X, Y, and Z, but my financial resources are mine own. Here we see implementing Reformation required this kind of sacrifice from Asa as well. Secondly, we see that it is an incomplete Reformation. Verses 16 to 24. It is an incomplete Reformation. Asa is a godly king, but Asa is imperfect. The Bible has a realism about it. There's a frankness about it. Whereas many writing history will cover over many things, bury them in oblivion, and bring out the virtues of a person, the Bible tells us the facts. Here's the good and the bad, and at times the ugly. Asa was a godly man. Now, there are many who comb the Bible, and they find the good people, and then they pounce on the things that are wrong, and they sit on those and say, look at the patriarchs, and look at the kings, and how horrible they were, and so on. To do so is to dishonor their God. Because the Bible says, in verse 14, noting his shortcomings, but the high places were not removed. Nevertheless, Asa's heart was perfect with the Lord all his days. The dominant characteristic of Asa is one of godliness, coupled, albeit, with his spiritual struggles. So he had done this work of destroying the idols, removing them from the land, removing the Sodomites, and so on. But we're told in verse 14, he left the high places. Now this was a grave, a serious evil, leaving the high places. The Lord had said, Jerusalem is the place. I have set my name. This is the location where my worship is to take place. These high places serve as competitors to what the Lord had appointed. So they are clearly evil and wrong. And so the Reformation is incomplete in that sense. He has not fully swept the nation clean of what needed to be removed. We also see political compromise. So in the verse 16, he's at war with Baasha. And what happens? Baasha comes, king of Israel. He parks 5 miles north of Jerusalem, and he creates a blockade. So what's that mean? It means he's cutting off the trade route that Jerusalem would be supplied by. You see this in verse 16 and in verse 17. And of course, Israel is bigger than Judah. They're stronger than Judah, more people, more resources, and so on. And it's in this circumstance that Asa caves to pragmatics. He caves to pragmatics. And he says, well, I'm going to have to arrange some things in order to get me out of this pickle, out of this difficult circumstance. And if you're looking at it merely in terms of pragmatics, you would have to conclude by saying, you know what? There was some wisdom there. It's worldly wisdom. But what he did worked. What he did, in fact, worked. You notice he goes to Syria and he says, let's make a covenant together. And then he robs the Lord of his resources and then takes his own resources, ships this off to the king of Syria and says, break your covenant with Israel, the northern kingdom, and attack them to get him off my back. And so the king of Syria sends troops to the far end of Israel, and they begin conquering those portions. And then Baasha has to say, well, I have to leave Ramah here, and he hightails it back to defend that portion of his territory. And so, you know, one could look at it and say, it worked. Asa got rid of him. And if that's not enough, Asa is able to send his people into Ramah, and they're able to collect all the supplies for free and to rob them of their supplies and to bring them back. And he actually uses it to fortify other cities. So in the end, he's even stronger than he was before Baasha came and started this blockade. So pragmatically speaking, everything looks great. The problem is, it involved spiritual compromise. It involves spiritual compromise. First of all, he enters into a league with God's enemies. Now, if you look at the parallel account in 2 Chronicles, we are given some details there that we don't have here, and you'll see the Lord's rebuke of Asa. In verse 9, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward him. Herein thou hast done foolishly. Therefore, from henceforth thou shalt have wars." Asa compromised by going into a league with God's enemies. He compromised by engaging in bribery, deception, and theft. He compromised by encouraging the king of Syria to break covenant with Israel, which is a sin, to break a covenant that they've entered into. Even if they swore to their own hurt, they should keep that covenant. And so there's a whole host of problems here. But it's reality, isn't it? It's something that we can appreciate and we have no doubt felt. There's a temptation. The pressure is on. There is great pressure, great complexity, great difficult circumstances, and the pressure is to rely on our own resources, to turn to the arm of flesh rather than to turn to God, to turn to worldly wisdom and do an end run around the Lord in order to get what we think is ultimately good for us, not trusting in God, not obeying the Lord, and not doing things his own way. And you need to be warned, because just because you're successful doesn't mean you followed the will of God, doesn't mean that there is faithfulness there or that God is pleased with it. The fact is, one of the worst things that can happen to us and does is when the Lord gives us success in our sinful compromises. Well, it's a disaster. Because Asa is funding enemies of God in confiscating parts of the promised land. That's God's land. They're up there taken away. And whatever beef there is between Israel and Judah at the present moment, that still is marked out by God as his land. He's funding the confiscation of a portion of the promised land. And if that's not worse, the Syrians become a greater threat to Asa's own kingdom as a result. It's almost as if we have deja vu. You look at things in the Middle East, in the political nightmare, you know, you fund one people and then to get rid of somebody else, and then those people end up being the people that you're fighting with the funds that you gave them later on, and so on. That's what we're seeing here. Well, what do we do with Asa? This is an incomplete reformation. What do we do with Asa? Is Asa good or is Asa bad? And I think I've already given the answer to that question. If we're to go by what God himself thinks, and that's the only way we should go, we have to say that Asa is a saint, he's a believer, a God-fearing man who is struggling as a sinner. He's a God-fearing man that is struggling as a sinner. He engages in biblical reformation at great personal sacrifice, but it is mixed with blemishes. Verse 14 gives it to us, "But the high places were not removed. Nevertheless, Asa's heart was perfect with the Lord all his days." It's biblical reformation at personal sacrifice mixed with blemishes. To say that he was a man after David's heart is to say that he's a man after God's own heart. Now, none of this should ever be used to excuse his or our sin. It's not as if we can say, well, he's a godly person, he's making mistakes, so we're okay ourselves. That would be a great provocation to the Almighty. It doesn't provide us with an excuse, but it does provide us with a measure of realism. And at least in that, there should be comfort in our own circumstances and failures. One of the gracious messages, one of the messages of God's grace here, is that a person can have a heart for God. That is even conceivable is itself miraculous. And the text shows us, yes, indeed, men and women, boys and girls, can have a heart for God, a passion for the purity of his worship and the preservation of his glory. The Lord's gospel grace is powerful enough to do that. And it does not matter what our genealogical history is. What matters is the power of God in the gospel. But as we see all through 1 and 2 Kings, we reach another conclusion as well. And that is, as excited as we were about Asa initially, and as disappointed as we are by the incompleteness of his reformation, we have reinforced in our hearts that yes, he's not the one. We still need a perfect king. Asa is an early reformer in the Old Testament. There are better ones that come after him, Hezekiah and Josiah, but even they have their obvious flaws. And really, you can look through the whole history of the church, Old and New Testament, post-apostolic era, and in the best and brightest days of the church, the men that God has raised up still had their blemishes. Right, we can say, there's Luther, all the ways that the Lord blessed him and used him. Luther had more than his fair share of blemishes. Look at Calvin, and so on. No, none of these fit the bill in and of themselves. The point is, Asa is not the one, the king. There's only one perfect king, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we turn our gaze to him, we see him making the ultimate sacrifice, one that transcends anything that men have within their reach. We see him engaging in the complete destruction and removal of idolatry. And we see him carrying out the work that God had commissioned him to do without a single instance of compromise, without one infraction of God's law. And this text reminds us that at the end of the day, we have him. We have the great King of all kings. And our faith is not in men, in ourselves or others, leaders or followers, but rather our faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ. This is our only hope, to be ruled and reigned by such a king as this. Salvation is not dependent upon our flawless track record, because there is none. It is built and based entirely upon him, upon his grace, gracious, saving, redeeming work and purchasing sinners for himself. Now, those who come to the Lord by faith and with gospel repentance will yield the fruit of the diligent pursuit of God's glory. The true Christian will have a heart for God. And the one who has a heart for God will, like Asa, be diligent and passionate about the pursuit of God's glory. That too is the work of God's Spirit and grace in us. Here we see that amidst all of the bleak circumstances, amidst all of the degradation that has proceeded with Rehoboam and Abijam, We see that promise that we heard earlier in this chapter. God will preserve a lamp in Jerusalem. For the sake of his king, David, who is a picture of David's greater son. In other words, for the sake of Christ himself, the Lord will, he has, he is, and he will preserve for himself a lamp in his church. And the gates of hell will not be able to stand against it. Our hope and confidence is placed in Christ's glorious reign. Stand together for prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, we are thankful for your word. We are thankful that because of the zeal that you bear for your own name, that you are pleased to raise up lights in darkness, that you are pleased to send your Spirit to equip men like King Asa to carry out the work that is connected to your glory. O Lord, our hope is found in you. You are our help, and we pray that you would give us an increased affection and attachment to Christ Jesus, and that our love for him would be manifest in our devotion to him and in our willingness to bear our cross in following him, to engage in personal sacrifice for the sake of seeking first his kingdom and his righteousness. O Lord, you alone are able with divine power to work such things in the sons of men. And so our eyes are upon you, O Lord. And we pray, come and grant to us your grace, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing together from Psalm 78, verses 5-8. The tune is Durham number 52, Psalm 78, verses 5-8. His testimony and his law in Israel he did place and charged our fathers it to show to their succeeding race, so that so the race which was to come might well them learn and know, and sons unborn who should arise might to their sons them show, that they might set their hope in God and suffer not to fall his mighty works out of their mind, but keep his precepts all, and might not, like their fathers, be a stiff, rebellious race, a race not right in heart with God, whose spirit not steadfast was. Verses 5-8.
To
stand for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Amen.